Hey everyone, for this week's lecture, we're going to cover building an API using Node. So far in this class, we've been building out our front ends with Ember, and it's been using Mirage as the fake API. Mirage is great for prototyping because it allows us to kind of fake out an entire API without actually having to write an API, and this allows us to move quickly with our front end. But it's not meant to be used in production because, as you've learned, it doesn't actually persist to a database. It just kind of keeps everything in memory, and so with every page refresh, all the changes kind of get blown away. So what I wanted to do today was kind of go over building out an entire, kind of a simple Node API and then connect it to an Ember app so you can kind of see just the entire process and what it might look like. So I have a database here. So if I list this out in my folder, it's called database.sqlite. And so SQLite is another type of database. It actually comes pre-installed on Macs already, which is great, so you don't have to really install anything. And the entire database is a single file, so we're just going to use this. So if you want to see what's inside this database, I can say SQLite 3 and then the SQLite database, with the file name. And then it kind of enters into this command line mode. And then I can run a few things. So I can say dot tables, and I'll kind of list out all the tables. I can even say things like, so SQL statements against any of these tables. So I could say select all from genres. And kind of see all the genres here, and it's only listing the values. But if you want to see maybe the like the column names, you can say dot headers on. Then I can rerun the query, and then you can see the headers here. So we're going to use this database and kind of make a little API and then connect it to our Ember app. So what I want to do is inside this API folder, I'm going to create a new file. This is going to be called app.js. You can call it anything you want. And for now, I'm just going to say console log hi. So I'll open up another tab in my command line. And then here with Node, we can run any JavaScript file by saying node and then the file name. So in this case, I said node app.js. It did the console log hi. And so you can make like little scripts and stuff that do different things. But this is the same way kind of how you get started with building an API node. We're just going to create a file name, and it's going to start up a web server and do all that kind of stuff. Okay, so what I want to do now is we're going to install a few different packages. So I'm going to create a new file called package.json, and we'll just kind of put an empty object in here. And we're going to install three different things. So we're going to use Express, which is kind of like a routing library for kind of creating routes for our API. Then we're also going to use like a database library. It's called a query builder, so it allows us to sort of write SQL-like commands in JavaScript and talk to our database. And it's called, I'm not exactly sure how to pronounce it, but it's K-N-E-X. Maybe it's Knex, but we'll use this. And yeah, I think it's just we're going to be using only those two. So I'm going to go to the command line, and then I'm going to say npm install express and then dash dash save. And this will write to the package JSON. And then I'm also going to do npm install next dash dash save. And this will also write to package JSON. And then if we look inside our package JSON, it was written, and now we can start using these. So inside our app.js, we're going to kind of import these in. And we saw imports in Ember where it said import something from Ember or kind of something along those lines. That was using kind of like the standard module system that JavaScript is going to be going forward with. Node currently uses, they're kind of in this transition phase, I believe, where they're kind of, the previous module system was called CommonJS, and then I think, sorry, that was my cat playing. Okay, yeah, sorry, I got a little distracted. So Node was kind of built initially using a module system called CommonJS. And so, and now like the entire like Node is, I think, merging towards like the standard ES6 module syntax, which is what you see in Ember. So it's a slightly different flavor of it, but eventually they'll all kind of use what it looks like in Ember. But for now, the way we kind of import it is we're going to say const express equals require, and then we put the package name, so in this case for express. And then we're also going to include that Knex. So I'm just going to say next. I could be wrong on how you pronounce this, but I'll just say const next equals require next. Okay, so to start up an Express app and start creating some routes, I can create an app, and the way we do this is we just execute that Express function that we're given, and then towards the end we'll say app.listen, and we're going to say what port do we want to listen on. We're going to say listen on, let's say 8000. I think it's, might actually just be a number. Yeah, so we'll just do this. Okay, so now we can actually just start creating routes. So I'm gonna say app.get. And so this means if I wanna make a get request to slash profile, then I can say function. And this function will receive two parameters, a request object and a response. And here, if I wanna just like send some JSON down, we can say response.json, and I'll just say something like name is David, pass in an object. This can really be any JavaScript value. And yeah, let's go with that and then kind of run this thing. So if I go back to the command line, I'll run node app.js, and it's gonna hang there because it's kind of waiting for requests. So if I open up my browser and go to localhost 8000, and then if I go to slash profile, we can see that the JSON was output. So this is a very static API, but using Express. So we created a route called profile. It responds to get requests. There's also methods for post, patch, put, and delete. Just kind of like what you saw in Mirage a little bit. But okay, so let's read from our database instead of just kind of spitting out just my name. Okay, so I'm gonna create a variable called Knex, or no, actually let's call this connection. And then we're going to execute Knex, and this kind of takes a little bit of configuration. So we need to tell it where the database is. And so this way we do that is we say connection, file name, and I'm just gonna say it's in the same folder. So database.sqlite. And then I also need to tell it the type of database. So there's a property called client, and we can say SQLite3. So that's all there is really to kind of tell Knex to connect to this database.sqlite file. Okay, so from here we can say connection dot, and then if you're familiar with SQL, then you're kind of familiar with like select columns from table name. In Knex, we're not writing actual SQL. It kind of gives us an abstraction a little bit, but it has similar language. So I'm gonna say select, let's see, from, and then the table name, which in this case was genres. And this returns a promise. So we can say, pass in a function to the then, then we can say response.json. And this promise will get resolved with the list of genres that we saw kind of when we did it over here in the terminal. So I'll say response.json genres. All right, so if I go back and refresh, or let's change the URL first, I'll say genres. Let's see, 8000, oh, because I didn't change this yet. All right, let's change it to genres. let's actually make it maybe something like API/genres. So I'll say API/genres. All right, what am I missing here? With Node, it doesn't actually refresh the file every time you make changes. So you actually got to stop it and then restart it and then refresh. All right, so maybe something, oh, we got an error. Let's see. NPM install. Oh, we also forgot to install one more file or package. We actually have to also install the SQLite package. So we're going to say npm install SQLite3 and save it. And this way, Knex knows how to work with SQLite. It doesn't actually work with SQLite and MySQL all just out of the box. You have to install these extra packages. Okay. So I installed it. I'm going to rerun Node. It's going to hang. I refresh. There we go. Now we see it. So just to kind of show you, like, it doesn't actually make changes, or if we make changes, it doesn't refresh. Let's just kind of change this route a little bit and then go back. See, it's still working. And so so you do have to kind of restart that. Now there's tools to kind of get around this, and there's a great tool called NodeMon. So if I actually stop and then I say npm install -g NodeMon, this works kind of like the node command. So instead of it saying node app.js, I can use nodemon. So I can say nodemon app.js. So very similar, but you can see it's waiting for file changes. And every time I make a file change, it'll just rerun basically node app.js. If I change this back to API genres, refresh, you can see that it restarted. So really good tool. I recommend using this. I don't do Node all the time, so I kind of forget this stuff a little bit, but okay. So refresh, we see our genres. Now, looking at this API, you know, I don't like the fact that it's kind of, these are the database column names, capitals, at least in a lot of APIs, the ID is just all lowercase ID, property names are all lowercase instead of, uppercase. So we can actually kind of modify this a little bit. There might be a way to do it from the next side, like when it sends a SQL statement, it'll pull it out and do it. But I'm just going to do it in JavaScript. So I can say I'm going to create a new array. I'll just call this, let's call this, we'll call it normalized genres, and it's going to equal genres.map. So we're going to kind of loop over each one, and I'm going to return a new object where the ID is equal to genre.id, and then name is equal to genre.name. Okay, and then we'll pass in normalized genres as the response. So if I refresh, okay, so we got name, must be missing, let's see, ID, let's see, what was it before? Oh, it was genre ID. Genre ID. Okay, refresh, cool, looks good. Okay, so we got an API. It's looking the way we want, at least property name wise. Let's do another one. Okay, so let's do, a get request for a single genre. So I'll say app get /API/genres/, and then I want to do a specific one. So it kind of, it works. I mean, the syntax is similar to what was in Mirage, where you use a colon, and so this will be a variable name, so we'll kind of pass in the ID, and this will return us the genre by, for that ID. So we'll pass in a function, we'll say request response, and then I'll take this connection stuff, just copy it over here, and I'm going to say connection dot select from genres. And I'm going to do it where the genre ID is equal to the ID. So I'm going to say where genre ID is equal to an ID. And so where do we get this ID from? So the ID is actually contained within the request. So up here I can say let ID is equal to request.params.id. So we're going to extract out the ID. We're going to pass it into where. And then this will give us kind of multiple columns back. In theory though, like only one, the ID is unique, so it'll be like an array of one. But I'm going to call first just to give us one back. And then it's going to return us a promise with the single genre. And then here we can say response.json genre. And I think that should be good. So let's try this out. So I'll do /genre/2, and that should be jazz. There we go. So we should have probably normalized these two so it's consistent with the array of genres. So here I'll just delete this and I'll say ID genre.genre ID name is genre.name. We could probably create like a better abstraction for this so it's not so duplicated, but you know, just using raw bare bones, this is fine. Refresh. Cool. Looks good. Okay, so you know, while we're here, let's actually just do a little bit of cleanup. So we'll just say function. Let's kind of abstract away this like connection stuff. So I'll create a function called connect. And I'll just return this. So I'll say return that. And then instead of you saying connect, so instead of saying connection, we'll just say connect. And we'll do the same thing down here. Okay, so that's kind of at least isolated to one spot. Refresh, still looks good. I believe we can even change these to arrow functions if you want, so I don't think it actually matters. So if you want to use kind of the newer syntax, we can. Yeah, so it looks like it still works fine. In some cases, like you can't, so you just got to be careful because it does have like, there's a slight difference between that and the other type of function, which I didn't really get into in this class, but it's worth looking up. Okay, so we have two endpoints. This looks good. One other thing that I usually like to do is with app listen, you can actually pass in a callback function. And so you can say something like log, listening on port, and then let's make the port a variable. So we'll say const port is equal to 8000. Well, here we'll say port, and then inside this message we'll say port. So now if I refresh, it's cool. And then if we look at here, it says listening on port 8000. So just a little bit of feedback, which is kind of nice. And let's maybe actually move this up to the top. Okay, so we have it up here with our other declarations. And so, so the API is looking good. So let's build an Ember app and then have it hit both of these endpoints. So I'm going to open up another terminal tab. I'm going to cd up one folder. So right now I have the API folder. I'm going to say ember new, let's call this, we'll call it genres. Or no, let's just call it actually front end. So while that's installing, one thing I want to go over was So I mentioned, okay, so these APIs are spitting out like a very simple type of JSON, right? And when we were using Ember and Mirage in this class, I mentioned that it uses this JSON API specification, which is a JSON standard. And so, you know, it doesn't look anything like this, but Ember has built-in support for very simple APIs like this without having to do any custom adapter and serializer changes. It's called, like, right now, or so far in this class, like, we went over the JSON API serializer. There's another serializer just called JSON serializer, and that works with this specific format where you have, like, either an array of objects or just a single object. So we'll use this one instead, and then we won't have to kind of write a bunch of customizations. We could have made it look like this, but this gets a little bit more verbose if you're just doing it by hand without a library. There are libraries in Node for making JSON API from, you know, sets of databases and stuff, but it's kind of beyond what I wanted to go into today. So we just kind of rolled it out from scratch, just very simple, and then spit out some simple JSON, which Ember supports out of the box. Okay, so we're going to cd into the front end folder. I'll open up Atom. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to say Ember serve. And I'll open up another tab just so I can do my Ember generate commands. So I got my database, my API, my Ember serve, and then my generator command for Ember. Okay, so I'll go to my browser, go to localhost 4200. Cool, we have our welcome page. So I'll go to app, and we'll go to templates, delete the welcome page, we don't need that. Okay, so I'm gonna create a model called genre. So let me kind of minimize this so you can see it a little bit better. I'll say Ember generate model genre. And then we'll also, while we're here, we'll say Ember generate serializer. We'll call this one application. And so this, if you create a serializer called application, this one is used for every single model. So we can assume maybe for this app, every single model will use the same type of serializer, which is the JSON one. So if I go to the app now, I can say, okay, let's go ahead and create a route. So I'll say Ember generate route index. So I'm gonna go to the route, and this is where we're going to write that model hook, and it's gonna find all genres. So I'm gonna say return this.store.findAllGenre. So we'll go to our model. And we'll create two property, or we'll create one property, so we'll say name, and this will be ds.adder string. Okay, so we got our model, we got our serializer, and if we look at the default serializer, it's using JSON API, so all you have to do is just delete it, the API part, and the one we're spitting out it works with this particular serializer. I wrote a blog post on it too if you want to see it, but there's like three main serializers in Ember: JSON API, JSON, and then another one called REST serializer. They all have, like, you know, popular formats for APIs. But let's check this out in the browser. So I'll open up console. Okay, so if we see this, it says error while processing route, trying to make a GET request to slash genres. So our API is prefixed with slash API slash genres. So I'm going to say, let's generate an adapter. And we'll just also create an application one. So every single model will use this application adapter. And here I'll say namespace is API. And this is using JSON API. I'm going to change this to REST adapter. So that's, there's only two adapters in Ember data, the REST adapter and the JSON API adapter. REST adapter is for pretty much everything else. JSON API is like JSON API specific. So now if we look at this, it's saying API slash genres. Cool. So the only thing that's different here is the port. So instead of 42,000 or 4,200, it's 8,000. So I'm going to set the host property here, and I'm going to say HTTP localhost 8,000. We'll save that. Okay, so pretty close now. So it's making the right call. Now we get this error, and so we're getting this CORS error. So CORS stands for cross-origin resource sharing. And so when you have two different domains, or one domain that's trying to make an AJAX request to another domain, there's a policy in place called CORS that prevents it for security reasons. And in this case, I think we can say we can enable it, and we can enable it for certain situations. So we could say only maybe certain domains are allowed to make AJAX requests to us. So that's what we're going to do. We're going to kind of enable CORS on our API side to say, hey, let's allow localhost 4200 to go through. This way it can make the AJAX request. So I'm going to go back to the API, and we're going to install a package for dealing with CORS. So if I just Google, or not Google, if I go to NPM and look for Express CORS, and then let's see, Node.js CORS middleware. I think it might be this one. Yeah, okay. So npm install CORS. So I'll go to the command line. I'll say, let me make sure I go to the right one. Well, okay. So I have to go to the API one. I'm going to say npm install CORS dash dash save. So it writes it to the package JSON. And we'll run node mon app.js again. And if we look at this, we require it here, and then we use it here. So let me go to the API. And just to be consistent, I'm going to use const. The only reason I'm using const here is because these things are never really changing. Some people say like use const for variables that are never going to be reassigned. In these cases, for like top level things like this, other people say only use const for actual constants like pi. I'm not really that opinionated on it, but I think this is what I've seen for most apps recently, so I've been going with that. Okay, so we've required or imported CORS into the project, and we're going to say app.use CORS. And so this use statement, this is installing something called middleware. So if we look at this CORS thing, it's saying CORS is a Node.js package for providing express middleware. So middleware is like functions that run before a request is processed. And so middleware can be used for things like checking headers or checking domains to see if like cross domain requests are going to be allowed. Maybe if you want to put your site in maintenance mode, you can kind of turn on a flag. And so before any route gets processed, it goes through the middleware and sees, oh, your app is in maintenance mode. We'll serve up a page that says the website is down. You've probably all seen that on some sites. Can be used for authentication too. So like protecting every single API route with some kind of authentication, you can put that in middleware. There's a lot of different use cases here. But just know that middleware is kind of like functions that run before like the main route gets hit. So we're applying this CORS middleware to our Express app. And I believe this, by doing this, it actually enables all domains. So there's probably more configuration here if you want to just say only certain domains. Let's see if we kind of scroll through this. See, here's CORS options. You could say like only this origin. But okay, let's try this out. So if I refresh, okay, so it's been blocked. Let's see. Oh, I didn't save it. Okay, refresh. Cool, it went through. And if we look at our Ember tab, if we look inside data, here's our genres. All of them got mapped correctly, and we can do stuff with it. So let's kind of finish out the Ember app part. So I'll go into our index template, and I'll say each model as genre. And then here I'll do a link to. So we'll say link to, or you know what? Actually, let's just do genre.name for now. And let's maybe put this all inside like an unordered list. So I'll paste that. Oops. All right, hold on a sec. Cat's trying to get in the box. Hey, stop. Okay, so let's go ahead and check this out. Cool, we got the list of genres being shown. Let's turn this into, let's generate another route. We'll go to our Ember command line. We'll say Ember generate route. Let's call it genre for displaying a single genre. And if I open up the router, we'll give this genre a path. We'll say the path is genre slash ID. Okay, so now we'll go back to index.hps and we'll put this in a link to. So we'll say pound link to genre, and we'll pass in genre.id. And close the link to. And so we'll pass along the ID to the link to, so each one becomes a link. And if we hover over it, we can see genre 1, 2, 3, 4, and so on. So now if I click on this, let's kind of hit the other endpoint that just pulls genre 2. So if we go to our route, so the genre route, we'll make the model hook. And this will receive the params, the dynamic segments from the genre route. And I can say return this.store.findRecord genre, and we'll say params.id. So remember, this ID matches up with the dynamic segment in our router. And so now, let's check to make sure the API call worked. So if you look, here's API slash genres 2. That's cool. And then we can go to our template. So the genre template, and we'll just say model.name. So model being genre. So we can see jazz. So now we've created a little Ember app that talks to a real API. Okay, so let me see how long I've been going for. Okay, so let's go ahead and I guess we can try and deploy this. Okay, so let's go ahead and deploy this. I'll deploy the front end first to Surge. So I'm going to install Surge. So let me kind of look up the add-on again. So Ember Surge. Okay, so Ember install, Ember CLI Surge. Say Ember install, Ember CLI Surge. And actually, let me deploy the API first. So there's a service I really like to use, Heroku. It makes it really easy to deploy things. And okay, let me turn off some of these. I think I ran out of, let's see, create new app. Oh, I guess I have enough. Okay, so we'll call this genres. No. Okay, let's call this NTP 404 genres. Hey, nice. Create app. Okay, so you have to sign up for a Heroku account first, but you can go through that process too. Okay, so the next thing is, all right, I'm gonna modify the API a little bit. So I don't want it to be on port 8000. I'm going to say, let's make it, we'll say process.env.port, and this is kind of an environment variable exposed by Heroku. So we can say, if this exists, we'll use this. So this way Heroku can set it. Otherwise, we'll just use 8000. Okay, so that should be good. And I believe, let's see. Okay, so the next thing I think we have to do is add scripts to the package JSON. And we're gonna add a command here called start. And so this is kind of like the entry point to Heroku will run this for us. So we can just say node app.js. And so when we deploy this to Heroku, they'll run npm start and it'll run this. Okay, so now I can do, okay, so let's initialize git. So I'll say git init. Oh wait, that's the wrong one. It's the Ember one. Let's go to the API. And let me just kind of close that for a minute. I can actually close off the database. I don't need this. Close that. Okay, so we'll say git init. You can install the Heroku command line tool belt, and that'll give you this. So you just kind of, Heroku CLI, just install that, and you'll kind of get this Heroku thing. So I'll just kind of attach this to it. So I'll run that. It's a relatively new computer. All right, maybe I have to install it. Okay, guess I have to install it. Download, save. Okay, for whatever reason, that took a long time to install. So let me rerun that command now that it's the Heroku CLI is installed. Okay, so this is, so entering my login credentials. This is the my Heroku login credentials. So let me actually look that up. Cool. So I've logged in to Heroku via the command line. So let me. Okay, so now I could push it up. So let me make a commit. So I'll say git add, or actually, so if I say git status first, we can see that we're about to commit node modules. So that's generally not a good practice, just because it makes your repository big. Instead, we can just, we can always just download it. So I'm going to add the git ignore. And let's add in node modules in here. I'll save that. Now if I do git status. Okay, so that looks good. I'll say git add all, git status, git commit, We'll say API done. Okay, so now we're going to say git push Heroku master. So that command, when we say Heroku git remote, it basically created another remote called Heroku. So when you typically you push to origin, which is usually GitHub, but now we've created another remote called Heroku. So we'll say git push Heroku master. And so when we push it up to Heroku, it's also going to deploy it for us, which is really nice, because if you ever done like deploying or just like making it live by FTP and stuff, you know, that's not, it's very manual and error prone, but with Git, it's just, you know, it's already part of our workflow if you're used to using Git. And so now we kind of use that same utility to kind of deploy it. So now, let's see. Okay, so now we deployed it to Heroku and it kind of tells us the URL, but we can actually go up here and we can say open app, and this will open a new URL. And it's probably gonna say, okay, cannot get route, right? So this is kind of the express thing. So if I actually, we saw it actually earlier for a brief second. So if I kind of go here and say slash API genres. Nice, we got a list of genres deployed. So we didn't really have to do a whole lot with Heroku, which really makes it easy. So, copy out this URL. Now let's deploy our Ember app to Surge. You could also deploy your Ember app to Heroku too, but we've been using Surge, so I'll minimize the API folder. Okay, so one thing here is we've imported or we've hard-coded the localhost 8000, so that's not going to be true when we deploy it to Surge. So what we can do is we can use this config folder, and let me just kind of close all this other stuff. Okay, so inside the config folder, there's the environment.js file, and we can say whether the environment is development, test, or production. So I'm gonna say, let's kind of add in, we'll kind of put this URL in the environment file since it changes based on whether we're in production or development mode. Okay, so app is generally where I put it. So I can say env.app dot, we'll call it like API endpoint is equal to that. So that's for the production case. And then for development mode, or we can actually just put it API endpoint. We'll just put it inside here. And for this, we'll just say localhost 8000. So there's that. And then inside our adapter here, we'll say import env from, we call it our project frontend slash config slash environment. So config slash environment is this folder path, and then this is the name of the project, which is when we did Ember serve. If you change your folder name, this does not mean it changes. This is actually sort of hard-coded when you ran that Ember new. It's in, let's see. It's an Ember CLI build? No. Might actually just be package.json. It might be the package.json name. But yeah, just kind of FYI, this is when you first created the Ember app. So here, I'm going to say, get rid of this. This will be env.app.api endpoint. So now it's a variable. So now if we, let's see if our front end. Oh yeah, so now it's failing just because we turned off like Ember serve, but it is trying to hit. Wait, actually, localhost 40 API is not found. Okay, here, let me make sure this works locally. So we have Ember serve running. We'll say node mon app.js refresh. Okay, so let's see, I made a mistake somewhere. returned a 404. So it's trying to do 4200. Okay, let me restart Ember server. Okay, I think I had to just restart Ember server because now I see it. Now everything works cool. Okay, so close that. Don't need this anymore. Okay, so we get rid of the console log. We don't need that anymore. So we installed Surge. So frontend.surge. So now we can actually just do, let's make a commit. So I'll say get add all, get status. So it'll be all the things we created. So git commit. I'll just say frontend done. And then Ember Surge. So you can see environment production, so it will use that Heroku URL. Oh, error, deployment did not succeed. Okay, let's try it and just see. Maybe it has to be a different URL. Okay, I think this was already taken and that's why it failed. Let's change that domain. All right, we'll just say, well, we did our API at ITP 404 genres. Let's actually just do the same thing. So in our CNAME, ITP 404 genres dash frontend. Let's do that. So I'll say Ember Surge. Cool, okay, so that was successful. So I guess if it hangs, it's maybe because the domain was already taken. Okay, so let's try this out. So I'll visit this URL. Cool. So it looks like it's working, and if I kind of refresh this and look at the console, we can see it is making the call to Heroku. So if I click on each one of these, see the calls being made, and we can actually inspect this. So look at these API calls. And oh, here it is. Access control allow origin. This is that header that makes you that allows cross-domain AJAX request to go through, so it's star, so it's allowing everything, but we could control that core's middleware to say, hey, only allow it from certain domains. But otherwise, that's working. So that's kind of an intro to building a little node, a node API that talks to a database, and then having a front end like Ember communicate to that API. The process is the same whether you're using Ember or not. Like if you're using React or Angular, you do the same thing. You just need to make sure you send kind of the right headers and do the environment stuff in order for the AJAX request to go through. Ember is really nice because they have this environment file that's kind of just already set up when you install it. So if, like, I know with React, I don't think it comes with it by default, so you'd have to like figure it out yourself, or maybe there's a third party package, but this is super handy having, just because we can configure URLs like this or other environment based variables. But yeah, if you're interested in kind of building more of the back end, I teach ITP 405 this spring. It's, like I mentioned, half server rendered using Laravel and PHP. And then the other half is a node, is based on Node. So JavaScript, Node, some Express, some more database stuff. There's other frameworks too that we look at, like Koa is one. and just kind of seeing the differences between kind of like your traditional synchronous-based programming like in PHP and then using JavaScript, which is asynchronous or has a lot of asynchronous stuff going on in Node, and kind of comparing the two technologies. So yeah, if you're interested, check it out. If not, I'll see you guys in a few weeks.